And knowing is half the battle.
G.I. Joe!
Because knowledge is power!
Or your acting, your music, or the controversy that surrounds you?
My big mouth. My big mouth. I got a big mouth. Can't help it. I talk from my heart. I'm real. You know what I'm saying? Whatever comes, comes. But my controversy, probably. And it's not my fault. I'm trying to find my way in the world. You know, I'm trying to be somebody instead of just make money off everybody. You know what I'm saying? And so I go down paths that haven't been traveled before, and I usually mess up. But I learn, you know what I'm saying? I come back stronger. You know, I'm not talking ignorant, you know what I'm saying? So I obviously put thought into what I do. So I think my mouth, my controversy. I have not been out of the paper since I joined Digital Underground. I've been in all, you know what I'm saying? It's never, my name has not been not uttered, you know what I'm saying? And that's good for me because I don't want to be forgotten. And if I'm forgotten, then that means I'm comfortable. And that means I think everything is okay.
It's interesting how hip-hop, rap music in the beginning, or a song like Grandmaster Flash is the message, where basically they were saying, you know, it's like a jungle sometimes. I wish, you know, I wonder how I keep from going under. The whole root of what that song was basically saying, look, these are the problems here. You know, and here we are 10 years or plus later. The problems are still there, and the intensity of the music has built to the no hope, the I don't give a attitude. How did we get from Grandmaster Flash, the message, to where we are now in hip-hop?
Again, you have to be logical. You know, if I know that in this hotel room they have food every day, and I'm knocking on the door every day to eat, and they open the door, let me see the party, let me see like them throwing salami all over the, I mean just like throwing food around, where they're telling me there's no food in here, you know what I'm saying? Every day, I'm standing outside trying to sing my way in, you know what I'm saying? We are hungry, please let us in, we are hungry, please let us in. After about a week, that song is gonna change to, we hungry, we need some food. After 2-3 weeks, it's like, you know, give me all the food, I'm breaking out the door. And after a year, then you just like, you know what I'm saying? I'm picking the lock, coming through the door blasting, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you hungry, you reached your level, you don't want any more. We asked 10 years ago. We was asking with the Panthers. We was asking with them, you know, with Civil Rights Movement. We was asking, you know, now those people that were asking, they're all dead and in jail. So now what do you think we're gonna do? Ask? And we shouldn't be angry? And my raps that I'm rapping to my community shouldn't be filled with rage? You know what I'm saying? They shouldn't be filled with the same atrocities that they gave to me. In the media, they don't talk about it. So in my raps, I have to talk about it. And it just seems foreign because there's no one else talking about it.
Right. Well, a playing devil's advocate, somebody might say, well, what does Tupac have? He's a movie star. He's got, you know, hit records. What does he have to complain about?
And I'm going to tell you. It's like being the last person alive. You know what I'm saying? After 3 days, you can't do anything. What can I do? Where can I go? There's no black neighborhood, you know what I'm saying, with black people who have the same amount of money as me. You know what I'm saying? There's richer and there's poorer. There's no just, you know, did a movie, got a little bit of money, living okay, black neighborhood. I have to be in a white neighborhood. So I don't fit in. That's hell. It's hell when you can't be around your peers. All my life I grew up around black people, poor people, but I can't live around poor people now because they'll rob me. And why would they rob me? Because they're starving, because there's no money here. But they're telling me, now that I made a little money, I have to move here. So it's not like no one's ever trying to deal with this section. They're just moving away from it. And we're gonna have more stars coming from together, but they're gonna all move this way. You know what I'm saying? So it's like all the society is doing is leeching off the ghetto. They use the ghetto for their pain, for their sorrow, for their culture, for their music, for their happiness, for their movies, to talk about boys in the hood. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to be another young. I don't want to be 50 years old at a BET We Shall Overcome Achievement Awards. You know what I'm saying? Uh-uh. Not me. You know, I want, when they see me, they know that every day when I'm breathing, it's for us to go farther. You know, every time I speak, I want the truth to come out. You know what I'm saying? Every time I speak, I want to shiver. You know, I don't want them to be like, they know what I'm going to say because it's polite. They know what I'm going to say. And even if I get in trouble, you know what I'm saying? Ain't that what we're supposed to do? I'm not saying I'm going to rule the world or I'm going to change the world. But I guarantee that I will spark the brain that will change the world. And that's our job, is to spark somebody else watching us. We might not be the ones, but let's not be selfish, and because we're not going to change the world, let's not talk about how we should change it. I don't know how to change it, but I know if I keep talking about how dirty it is out here, somebody's going to clean it up. I was having concerts, they were sold out, white boys, Mexicans, blacks, and they would do whatever I said. I could tell all those people in the audience to turn around in a circle, and they would do it. I was having love, I mean, like undeniable love, and I was scared. I was scared that I would come to a town and I have the leader of the gang there telling me, what do you need? I was scared, but so was America. So was somebody else, because all of a sudden I had all kind of legal problems. And you have to think about this. I had a clean record for 20 years, a clean record, living in the ghetto, in the gutter, no record. What about my morals then? What about my character then? You know what I'm saying? In 2 years that I start raising noise, that I start being publicly viewed, I've had a record. And now it looks like I'm a criminal who has no way of being reformed. But all of these came one after the other. Do you understand?
Right.
It takes logic.
Well, what about, that's another interesting part of your past. Have you ever been incarcerated before?
Have I ever been incarcerated?
Yeah.
No, not for longer than a day. Long enough for somebody to take me. You know, the police can arrest anybody they want, put them in jail. But if you stay there, that, you know what I'm saying? I haven't stayed anywhere. Right. I've been arrested a lot, put in a cell, and they come and get me when I call my lawyer. You know what I'm saying? But I'm an innocent type of guy.
Well, I wanted to bring up, obviously tomorrow is a big day. You're being sentenced tomorrow.
Yeah.
And, we're sitting here in 24 hours, you'll know what the situation's going to be. Are you thinking about the prospect of going to jail?
First I was like, I'm not going to jail. I was like, if they try to come get me for something I didn't do, I'm gonna open fire. You know what I'm saying? But I can't do that because it's not just me anymore. You know what I'm saying? That's what they expect. If I have to, if God sees it fit for me to spend time in a cell, if he wants my brain to be inside of a cage, if he's brought me so far from hell to put me here, and now he wants me to go to jail, I'll go. You know what I'm saying? If that's where I'm meant to be. But I don't think so. I don't think so. You know what I'm saying? I don't really believe in my heart that I belong in jail. I don't believe I did anything to warrant me going to jail.
Okay. What do you think, if you do go to jail, is to be expected because you are a known personality?
I'm going to ask to be put in solitary confinement, and I'm going to do push-ups and read books and come out weed-free, smoke-free, and with a degree or some shit. You know what I'm saying? I won't let it stop me, you know what I'm saying? But I'm not going to jail to just parlay. If I went to jail, best believe, it's not like I'm going to have a problem in jail. I got love there, you know what I'm saying? I got love from thugs and the street dudes. And I could go to jail and probably organize a riot, you know what I'm saying? But that's not what I want to do. If I have to go to jail, I don't even want to be living. I want to just cease to exist for however long they have me there. And then when I come out, I'll be reborn, you know what I'm saying? I'll be taking less problems. And that my mind will be sharper and the venom will be more potent, you know what I'm saying? So they shouldn't send me there. They should really try to appease, you know? It's like you don't throw more gasoline on the fire to put it out.
Mm-hmm. What about, this is one step and there's some other, cases that are going to be coming up. What has changed for you? And you mentioned the last 2 years is when everything started to happen one after the other. What changed for you in these 2 years? How is your life now different than it was before?
Like I said, it was no spot for Tupac. It's not like there was somebody like me before and I moved into the spot so I can ask him how he did it. You know what I'm saying? There was no spot here. Nobody wanted to be, the person that thugs and the street people could rally around. Nobody wanted to be that. So when I was that, I couldn't handle it. You know what I'm saying? I could handle it, but not right away. Of course, I had problems. I was making mistakes that anybody would make when you have 14,000 people ready to do whatever you want. You know what I'm saying? When you have all over the country people waiting to hear what you want to do. You know what I'm saying? This Thug Life code, we have a code putting order to the violence on the streets. And when they all listening to you, I got people in the penitentiary, you know what I'm saying? Big time OG criminals who are calling me, telling me they want me to lead their movement. I mean, I'm going to have a problem. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to have a small identity crisis here. You know what I'm saying? Because, I was from a single father. You know what I mean? A single mother with no father, no male figure. Now I got every man in America who wants to take an order from me. You know what I'm saying? Who wants to know what I want to do or, you know, what's my plan for young black males. And that makes me scared, but that makes me want to rise to the occasion. You know what I'm saying? What makes me want to give my whole life to him. And I will give my whole life to this plan that I have for Thug Life.
Now, when you said a code, I don't know exactly what do you mean by a code.
I organized the OGs in the East Coast and the West Coast and the penitentiaries to come up with a set of codes of ethics for criminals. You know, like we're going to be against drive-bys, kidnappings, attacks on people that are not involved with the street gang, with the drug trade, or the illegal business at all. You know, all that kidnapping and shooting drive-bys out the car, we're against that. And people who perpetrate that, they have to deal with the consequences when they go to jail, because that's who's going to enforce this code and the thug life that's on the street. It's like we're cleaning up the dirt. I can't change what the dirt that's here, but I can put all this dirt in one corner. You know what I'm saying? Somehow I have some order here. And for that, they need to give me a little leg room. You know what I'm saying? Let me do what I want to do, because nobody else is going to do it. Nobody else wants to do it. But I'm not scared to walk in the middle of Watts, Compton, Chicago, wherever, and sit down with whoever's the OG and say, this is what we need to do. I didn't want to change. I love that, you know, even though I was with Janet Jackson, with big movies and all that, I'll be up at the dirtiest house party in the hood. And people could not believe it. And I used to thrive off that. Being up in the party and somebody turn around and go, oh my God, that's too hot. And everybody going crazy because I'm up in a dirty party, no security, lights out, drinking, hella drunk, you know, drunk with everybody else. But that's what kept my sanity. That's what kept me writing. That's what kept me going. My fans know that I'm real. My fans go to jail just like me. They understand me. Half my fans are white. The white fans, they listen just as much as the black fans. The ones that have approached me, I've been genuine fans. These are the people that are going to have jobs in the future and are going to hire my family. But many of my fans don't have ID. Some have jobs, some don't. Some are on welfare, you know what I'm saying? Some are not. Some are rich and some are poor, but they all share that hopeless feeling. Thug Life hit me like the Holy Ghost. It cuts both ways. To me, it's like when I say I live the thug life, baby, I'm hopeless. One person might hear that and just like the way it sounds, you know what I'm saying? But I'm doing it for the kid that really lives a thug life and feels like it's hopeless. So when I say hopeless, and when I say it like that, it's like I reach him. You understand? And even if when I reach him, it makes it look glorious to the guy that doesn't live that life, I mean, I can't help it. It's a fad, you know. He'll drop the thug life soon enough. But for the person that I was trying to reach, he'll pick it up and I'll be able to talk to him again. I'm thinking I'm being responsible, but it's hard. Once you start worrying about what you're saying, I get writer's block. Kind of like, I can't say that. That's too harsh. Can't say this. Now I have to just block it out and trust my heart that I'm doing the right thing. When did I ever say I was a gangster rapper? You know what I'm saying? I'm a thug. When I'm saying thug, I mean not criminal, someone to beat you over the head. I mean the underdog. The person that had nothing succeeds, he's a thug. Because he overcame all obstacles. It doesn't have anything to do with the dictionary's version of thug. To me, thug is my pride. Not being someone that goes against the law, not being someone that takes, but being someone that has nothing. And that even though I have nothing and there's no home for me to go to, my head is up high. My chest is out, I walk tall, I talk loud, I'm being strong. I don't understand why America doesn't understand thug life. America is thug life. What makes me saying I don't give a fuck different than Patrick Henry saying, give me liberty or give me death? What makes my freedom less worth fighting for than Bosnians or whoever they want to fight for this year?
Before Thug Life, when you were with Digital, working as a roadie and as a dancer, mm-hmm. Was that real? I just read that you used to like do dance, you know, the dances with the plastic.
Do dance with the naked doll. That was me. That's what I mean by I'm real. I'm truly hardcore because I needed the money and I had to work. So if he told me that for me to get paid, I had to go out there in bikini briefs and hop on top of this doll, and that's how I got to get paid. And I was homeless at the time. That's what I had to do. You know what I'm saying? But what I did was not let him pimp me. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't like I just did that because that was my order. As soon as I got the chance to say what was on my mind,
I said what was on my mind. And we have a platinum record now. You know what I'm saying? So I went from dancing naked with the dolls, being unknown, to now having a platinum record. You know what I'm saying? And now I don't have to never touch another naked doll. I'll never have to dance, jiggle, nothing. I can hire dancers. You know what I'm saying? I got three people dancing. I can have people dancing in the audience. You know what I'm saying? Well, you have to work from one point to go to another point. So I admire the work ethic. I think that it should be reinforced throughout our neighborhoods, that everybody should work hard. Practice makes perfect. You have to be diligent about what you want. You have to apply yourself. You have to motivate yourself. And you have to do it for self, by yourself. And then you can do things for other people. But that's what I had to do. I had to do for self.
You gotta get yours. Do you feel in any way by having a 40, having a gun and a blunt, if that's glorifying the use of that to children?
It might. I thought about that, you know. I thought about how much that, you know, 40s and all of that, and I was kind of against it before, but whatever I wrote was honest. It might not have been positive, you know what I'm saying? It might not have been politically correct, but I've reached somebody, you know what I'm saying? They relating to me. They relating to the brutal honesty in the rap. There's no Jesse Jacksons around, you know what I'm saying? Those people weren't around. All those people that pop up and say, we need to check what we're saying in the rapping and TV, those people are not around. It's Frank Sinatra, a gangster singer, you know what I'm saying? It's Steven Seagal, a gangster actor. Rap about the oppressed taking back their place. My lyrics and my verses are about struggling and overcoming. I mean, women know that there are bitches out there. I don't know why women look surprised. They know. They say it louder. They just think that we're saying they're all bitches. That's not what we're saying. I give a holler to my sister's own welfare. Tupac kids, if don't nobody else care. And that's why I tried to do with Keep Your Head Up and Get Around. I said, I'm gonna write a song about the women like my mom or the women like my sister, who I think represent a strong black woman. I did that. Now I'm gonna rap about the women that I see every day, and that was Get Around. If I just did songs like Keep Your Head Up, it would make me seem more than what I am, but I'm just a normal man. I get love. I still get love from my community. I owe them everything. That's what I owe everything to the hood. I cannot give it up. I don't understand how people could stand next to you 1 year and next year they cannot stand there. They just going crazy screaming. They just can't take it that you're right there. But just last year, I was in the same club, walking around lonely like a motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? Couldn't get a date. Couldn't get nobody to dance with me. I was too skinny, too something. And now he's just adorable. He's just, oh.
Well, how did your relationship or lack of a relationship with your father influence who you are today?
Because I didn't have a father, I thrived for the family, you know what I'm saying? So that's what made me be able to do this work. That's what makes me be able to accept all black people as my family. You know, that's part of my downfall. But because I didn't have a father, it makes me cold and bitter. Not just as the excuse. I know people are tired of hearing, I have a father, we had a rough life. But, you have to be logical, you know what I'm saying? The reason I didn't have a father, it's not like I'm saying, okay, now sympathize with me. I'm saying, remember that I'm telling you I did not have a father. So when you go, what kind of kid is that? What kind of morals do we got? I don't know. You know what I'm saying? I was raised by a Black Panther, you know, and out of jail. I was raised on, like, by a lot of street people. So, of course, my values are real street-orientated. But that doesn't mean that I don't have any values or I don't have any morals. You know what I'm saying? It's just that my morals are applied to the people who I'm around.
If you had a father figure growing up, how would you be different? Would you be different right now?
I think I'd probably be a lawyer somewhere, you know, because I wouldn't have hung out. I wouldn't have looked for that father figure. And I wouldn't have learned all this treacherous street game that now I can't forget. Because I was raised by a woman half my life and then thrown to the streets, it's like I got the woman side, then I got real rough, manly values, like forced on me.
So sizzling. Don't be so sizzling, too. Well, basically,
Boogaloo.
Boogaloo.
Mon Wayne's time playing the role of Boogaloo.
What is Boogaloo?
Where did that name come from,
some white guys didn't know. What's a homeboy name? Boogaloo.
What are they calling each other these days?
I got a song called Pain.
Yeah,
I wrote it as soon as I got out of jail after getting charged, and I felt it, you know what I'm saying? Basketball is, and I hate to make this sound cliche, you know, like, all us black folks need to get out the ghetto is a basketball.
Or dance.
You know what I'm saying? But it's not like that in this story. It's not like basketball in terms of him going to college. It's just basketball in terms of there being something for him to concentrate on, you know, something for him to get his mind away from the negative.
And that's the action in our movie, is the basketball. It's like guns and Die Hard. You know, it's the action.
I like playing the bad guy, but I want to play a bad guy that's for real, like a Robert De Niro or
Harvey Keitel,
you know what I'm saying, with some substance and character, you know, and not just a crazy fool with a gun. I chose a razor because in the streets of New York and the club scenes, you know, that the thugs carry razors in their mouth. And when they get into altercation, they spit it out and cut. You know what I'm saying? I said, I was amazed. I was like, that's raw. That would really scare somebody. And that was part of the fear that I wanted to bring to Birdie. It must be hard for a director to have his main character in jail. You know what I'm saying? And you have to shoot tomorrow. You know what I'm saying? But they never let me feel that. You know, I came on the set and it was just like I left last night. Am I crazy or what? Hell no, I ain't crazy. I wasn't crazy when you was interviewing me. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't crazy when we were sitting up there when I had the pain in my... But it's okay. They got to sell, you know, magazines, and that's fine. You know, I understand. But I don't... To me, we just had a long interview. I don't seem crazy. You know what I'm saying? I seem logical. What's really going on is this is a crazy world. And if you're not a tad bit crazy, you will not survive.